Well, hello and welcome to all of you visiting us here today at Gold Lactation. I'm Fiona Langsharp, IBCLC Director of Communications and MC here at Gold Learning. Well, it's my pleasure to bring back today Duncan Fisher. He is with us once again here at Gold Learning and going to be speaking at our upcoming Gold Lactation Conference. Now, this is a topic not to be missed. This has really become quite a hot topic, I believe, in our communities, and it seems like finally, I'm sure Duncan's going to say, really getting some airtime in what's happening. I think for some of the things that I'm really curious about is, you know, where did it all come from? How did it start? And why weren't we doing this sooner? But of course, we'll get into that in just a moment. We'll be talking about the topic that Duncan is going to be sharing on, of course, at the upcoming conference, how to enhance breastfeeding a lot. Engage fathers. So this is going to be coming up live at our Gold Lactation Conference. Now, if you didn't know, the conference starts on March 30th. So it is really right around the corner. You can go to the website right now, goldlactation.com, register to be part of that conference. Don't forget that our keynotes, of course, will be live and open access. You'll be able to listen to the recordings too. Duncan, of course, is going to be with us on Monday, the 6th of April. So you can book that on your calendars right now to make sure you can be part of that live event. Always great to come and join us because you'll be able to ask questions, of course, to Duncan on the day. And of course, if you can't make it on the day, we'll be sure to have that recorded for you as well. Well, without any further ado, please let me introduce and welcome once again, Duncan Fisher, for being with us here today. Welcome, Duncan.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
Yeah, well, it's really my pleasure, to have this topic come back here at Gold. And you, of course, have spoken with us before at one of our other conferences, which was wonderful. But here we're focusing on breastfeeding in families and how this has developed, just over the last few years. It looks like you've been quite busy. So why don't you give us an update really on what you've been doing? How's family? How's life? How are you balancing it all? Because everybody wants to know that as well. So share a little bit about what's been happening with you.
I work mainly from home in Wales in the United Kingdom, and you may have seen in recently my hometown. It was the one in all the pictures of the floods.
Yes.
So we've been underwater, not fortunately my own house, but it's been quite a thing for the community. Mm-hmm. And so in the last year on the breastfeeding, The big progress was the World Alliance for Breastfeeding Action. They published a sort of action guide to engaging with fathers in breastfeeding. So we worked with them on that over the year. I attended a conference there in Malaysia, and so that was a big advance because that put the agenda across the world through the World Breastfeeding Week last year.
Yes.
The other highlight is that the World Health Organization is right now doing another review of engaging fathers in maternal and newborn health, and a research review, and they will then develop recommendations later this year and possibly into next year. So that's the other sort of highlight. So both things are, they're not a huge amount of work for me because I've done the work in terms of all the research, but but they're big step forwards in the agenda becoming more mainstream.
Right. Yes. Actually having someone pick it up of a sort of authority placement and getting it out there to the masses must be huge for you, because I know that this has become, this is your work, your passion, and so when you got that call from, the World Alliance Association, and what was it like? I mean, when you were invited to sort of get this, into an actual paper?
Well, it was quite surprising. I mean, I've been doing this for such a long time,
right,
without any engagement whatsoever, just because I knew it was right. Mm-hmm. The evidence speaks for itself, mm-hmm. but the way the agendas are organized at the international level, it makes it incredibly difficult for this sort of approach, what mm-hmm. I'm recommending, right. actually to catch on. It's not that people disagree with it, it's mm-hmm. just that the whole setup can't really handle it. Right. I spent a lot of time working without any connection, you know, just mm-hmm. reviewing the literature, writing pieces, communicating with people, making networks. So when you get a bit of a breakthrough, but you have to wait a very long time for these things to happen.
Right.
And then just be ready when they do. And I think that's the way it'll work in future, that is suddenly something will turn up that I wasn't expecting and that I wasn't ready for, but suddenly it's there and you have to respond.
And
that's what happened with the World Health Organization. I had no warning whatsoever, just suddenly there it was.
And so, you know, so there's a couple of things I'm thinking of right now, and I mean, many people will agree that research that is done does take a long time to get into any amount of formal protocols. We know how long it takes, you know, often to get into journals, get into physicians' offices, you know, where it becomes normal language once again. And again, just to recap on, you know, what we're talking about is how breastfeeding does change, how it improves when we engage fathers. So for a long time, as long as we can remember and our parents and grandparents can remember, breastfeeding just didn't get, you know, spoken about, even though it was done, you know, 100 years ago, but it really wasn't, we didn't engage other than, you know, the women that were within our midst, and fathers were really left out. So there was no skill building for a long time. And then the rates of breastfeeding dropped, which must have just compounded things as well, I'm assuming. Is that correct, Duncan?
Yeah, yes. I think the modern lifestyle, mm-hmm. In different cultures, the pressures on breastfeeding are different. But definitely the role of you know, families in breastfeeding is also quite different in different cultures, the way mm-hmm. it operates. But the fact that family members are very influential is cross-cultural. I mean, it's a universal principle that every woman, no woman is an island. Every woman is connected, and those connections have a lot of influence on everything that she does around mm-hmm. raising a child. So it's a universal principle about how it operates in different cultures, and how you engage with fathers in different cultures is different, which is one of the things I will be presenting, some of that diversity.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's very exciting. And what you said, you know, in the fact that it's universal. This is something that, you know, families, how they operate and behave and how they can encourage and those types of things. That's something that that's really tangible, that you can really hold on to, which is fantastic. Okay, so let's dive into, I mentioned to you off air, I want to know about all these committees. So go ahead and go and read Duncan's bio, and you'll see how busy he is on a lot of different things. You just tapped into it a little bit there, talking about, so you serve 3 years on the Board of Government's Gender Equality Board, Equal Opportunities Commissions. So tell me, how did you get involved with all of those things as well?
Well, at that point, I was one of the leading people in the sort of public conversation about fatherhood, mm-hmm. and the gender equality body at the time noticed that, mm-hmm. and realized that how caring is organized in society is just as much a determinant of gender roles as how work is organized. So the Equality Commission at the time was focusing mainly on work, you know, how do you make work more accessible to women, but brought in that other dimension of, well, how do we share care more, so that women can work more, so that that, you know, so the two things are bound together. Absolutely. The caring equation never gets mm-hmm. nearly as much attention as it does in some countries. I mean, the Scandinavian countries take it very seriously.
You know, they do take it very seriously.
They realize that actually mm-hmm. one of the main drivers of gender inequality mm-hmm. is the fact that women care for children more than men do, mm-hmm. and that obviously in some families that's what they want. It's mm-hmm. not have to share it,
right?
But there are structural barriers which skew it, mm-hmm. and when you change those barriers, behavior of parents changes a lot.
Right.
So, for example, if you have the right kind of leave entitlements in place, then mothers and fathers do share care more
right.
Than they do otherwise. So there are barriers that are holding it in place. So they brought me on board basically to bring that issue into sharp mm-hmm. focus. So that's what I did at that point.
Excellent. To me, it's just really, there's so many layers to it. I don't think sometimes when you're not, of course, not being in that position, you don't think through all the elements, even though you might support it. But it's really encouraging to hear you talk about all the different levels and layers that there really are to this, and how it all becomes really how it is all interconnected to support yes. each other. So that's really incredible. And I'm hoping that you're going to talk more about that, during your presentation, because I think that's one of the things people really need to dive into and be clear about, have a better understanding so that they can communicate that to those yeah. that are in the community and become sort of leaders of sorts in terms of making sure that these things are developed either in their communities and or those barriers are taken down.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So let's talk a little bit. I want to give you a little bit of airtime here just to talk about your, I know that you have a blog. What else have you? You've got a couple of website resources and those types of things. Do you just want to give a little shout out to those two, please, Duncan?
Yeah. So I've been, since 2015, I've been tracking all the published research from around the world on engaging with fathers in mm-hmm. in maternal and newborn health, in breastfeeding, in neonatal care, and basically summarizing the research and putting it on the website called familyincluded.com, mm-hmm. which I'll talk about in the presentation. I think there are about 400 articles now.
Wow.
And that's just a resource, basically. Right. I use yep. it when I'm making presentations. I use it because mm-hmm. I've read all the research and I've made notes on it, as it were, but published them. And occasionally I've then got together, as I did with breastfeeding and also neonatal care, a group of researchers. So let's do a summary briefing, practice briefing
yep.
that brings it all together. Did that for breastfeeding, did it for neonatal care. Neonatal care, we then actually published it in an academic journal. So that's what I do there. The other project is the Child and Family blog.
Right. I see that.
That's more focused on child development.
Okay.
And the family influences on child development. And that's a project with Cambridge and Princeton universities. And we report on the latest research, mm-hmm. high quality research, and we have an editorial board and so on. And that's growing too. That's beginning to take off. That's a much more substantial project. So basically it's about communicating the research into policy and practice. Mm-hmm. That both sites do that. And the Family Included site was the reason the World Health Organization got in contact, because they
Fantastic.
Found the website and they
right.
thought, oh, we need to talk to this guy. So basically that's how that happened.
Yeah, so you said sometimes it's good trouble, right? You were in
yes.
good trouble.
But I did it for 5 years before anyone noticed, you see. I mean,
right.
that's not true. Several hundred people follow it and get
right.
all the content, because if you subscribe on it, you get the I send it everything by email, so
right
I'm sending hundreds of reports out every week.
That's
but
awesome.
It's still a small community
yeah.
of people
yeah.
getting it, but basically it's my experience with other things as well. You need to mm-hmm. plod on for a long time before it's noticed,
right.
and slowly build up the resource. I mean, no one's paying for that. It's just something that I'm doing because
yes.
I know it's important
yeah.
and just because it's not being noticed that doesn't mean you should give up. It just means you have to wait longer.
So suddenly
I'm not waiting. It's happening. So
yeah, I mean, that's inspiring for, I think, many people listening in, because there's lots of different avenues and areas that people do work in the field of lactation that doesn't get noticed, including this one. What you're saying is keep working at it. Eventually it'll pay off in terms of at least maybe not in the financial sense, because I know we talked about too. I know you put your heart and soul into this, and you don't get anything from the resources that you put out there, but certainly the love and care that you've put into the field has really paid out, I think, for so many families, and will continue. And I think that's one of what one of your goals was.
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
Well, that's wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Duncan. Boy, we have lots to talk about, and I know that we'll get more time together, airtime together, when we're online for a Gold Lactation Conference. But today we're going to wrap things up, and I'm just going to say thank you so much again for joining us. I can't wait for the full presentation, again titled How to Enhance Breastfeeding a Lot, Engage Fathers. And so be sure that we're communicating well and we're bringing them in. It's going to save us, you know, so much. I think about being a lactation consultant, Duncan, and, you know, having more people on board when you're sharing information with a parent who's breastfeeding. It's just, it's a no-brainer. So always bringing them in, but making sure that we know what the barriers potentially could be and their thought process and how they have been culturally raised is going to be so valuable to us as well. So thank you so much.
Pleasure. I look forward to the presentation.
All right. And as you said, we'll keep plodding along, good British term, and we'll keep making this work. So that's wonderful. So for all of our viewers listening in, don't forget, you can head to the website right now, goldlactation.com. Registration is open for this conference. We can't wait to see you there. It starts on March 30th. So don't forget to join us for that fabulous live opening keynote with Bruna Sampi. And of course, Duncan Fishen will be with us here on Monday, 6th of April. Thanks so much for joining us here today, and have a wonderful rest of your day. Bye-bye for now, everyone.